Hello, this is Mayor Thatcher Keezer, and this is the Mayor's Report for December 4th, 2012. And I'm pleased to have two guests today with us. I have Mike Basque, who's the Chief Financial Officer for the City of Amesbury, and Sam Wilmot, who is the Chair of the Amesbury High School Athletic Hall of Fame. So we'll be speaking to each of them on various subjects. But before that, let's go through some updates of some activities going on in Amesbury, some updates on some construction projects. First of all, I'm pleased to announce that Amesbury is a recipient from the Patrick Murray administration to receive support from the Brownfield Support Team from the state, which is a technical team of experts that are going to come in and help assist us in achieving the funding and provide the expertise for cleanup of any of the soils in the Lower Mill Yard area that need to be cleaned up before development can occur. It's an objective of the state team to assist municipalities to get these projects moving forward, get the brownfield cleanups going for economic development within the communities. Amesbury was one of a few communities that have received this designation for this round. And it'll, again, provide assistance for us as we move forward to revitalize the Lower Mill Yard and provide the economic development that we are looking forward to for Amesbury. So again, it's a very small group of municipalities that have been selected for this. Joe Fahey, our economic development director, has put a lot of effort in this application, and we are very pleased to be a recipient of the Brownfield Support Team from the governor's administration. Next, good news on the financial front for Amesbury. Standard & Poor's bond rating agency has given Amesbury an increase in its bond rating from an A to an A+. And we'll talk a little bit more about this with Mike Basque, our Chief Financial Officer, as to how this came about and what does this mean for Amesbury. Next, some congratulations to the Amesbury football team, the high school football team, and the Amesbury women's soccer team, both champions, league champions, successful seasons this year. At tonight's school committee meeting, we will be giving recognition to the players. I don't know if all of them are going to fit in the room, either the seniors, captains, but anyways, we're going to give recognition to our successful athletic teams this year. And we'll have some more conversations also on the show about our athletics here in Amesbury High School. Some updates on construction projects. One, the Elm Street Enhancements Project, which is the section of Elm Street from the R Street Bridge into the downtown. It is about 80% complete. Most of the sidewalk improvements have been done, the curbs. There are some sections that will need to be done in the spring. The section across from the gas station where there is actually a bridge, there is a sidewalk section that will be prefabbed next year and put in place. And because of that bit of construction, some of the sidewalks on both sides of the street in that area will be put off till next year, early next year in the spring. There has been, even today, recent patches done on the sidewalk connecting that unfinished portion into the transportation building and senior center to help folks who may be walking in and out of that area. So Amesbury moves forward. Again, this is part of a grant we received from the governor, $1.25 million grant in order to make enhancements to that section of Elm Street. So there was a lot of improvements made under the street. The street itself has some extensive patches on the street. Typically, when there's any significant improvements made in infrastructure under the road, the DPW waits till after a winter season in order to do a final paving over the top in order to allow all the soils underneath to compact and to settle in order to not have a brand new road sink into the ground. So it's significant patches. If there's any more settling of that area that creates too large of a bump, there'll be some additional patches, and then in the spring we expect to have that whole section paved after the final improvements are made. Next, the Route 110 widening project, which has been talked about many times here and in other forums to give updates. I'm pleased to say it is complete. The road is widened, traffic is flowing, and we look forward to the positive impact on traffic flow next summer during the summer traffic. It should be much improved. The biggest improvement is the 495 northbound exit ramp, that cars are able to come off that exit ramp onto their own lane, not having to back up onto the highway. And that's allowing a lot more traffic to flow through. So great improvements in that area with the completion of that project. Next, we have the fire station project, still ongoing. The project had to go through a site plan review with the planning board. Any of these type of construction projects on building projects, there's quite amount of work that needs to be done to permit, to obtain the permits for these projects before there's visible work that gets done. The engineering work has been completed for the design of what needs to be replaced inside the fire station. The site plan review approval by the planning board means we can now bid this project out, and physical construction will begin this spring. And that project will continue through most summer into the fall. Next, we have completed a number of street paving projects and drainage improvement projects throughout the city. Folks must be noticing the number of streets that have new pavement on them. Again, this is part of my accelerated paving program, in which we used free cash, which is another name, or the name that the state uses for unrestricted reserve funds that we applied, we gave to DPW to supplement the funding that's already in the DPW budget for making these improvements. It's given us an opportunity to get more streets paved, get drainage repaired, other infrastructure under the roads, as we try to accelerate it to make up really for decades of not keeping up on the maintenance needs of the roads and sidewalks and drainage. So given the improved financial position of the city, we're able to invest more money into these type projects. And so there are numerous streets that have been done. The plan and expectation is to pick up in the spring where we left off this fall. I am planning on submitting to the City Council another $200,000 for this next season, construction season, to continue the accelerated paving program. For information on what streets are going to be done, we have information on the website under DPW for the list of streets that are in the next cycle of paving. And finally, in line with that, the Fern Ave Bridge is open. It's actually been open for about a month and a half. We've had a contractor come in and replace the bridge that was damaged during various floods. First flood that it was impacted under my time here is in the 1996 Mother's Day flood. I'm sorry, the 2006 Mother's Day flood that caused damage, and then there was some subsequent storms that created more damage that put the bridge out. The city, particularly Rob Damaris, DPW director, worked very hard at getting FEMA funds, obtaining FEMA, Federal Emergency Management funds, to pay for the bridge rather than using our own city funds. It took us longer to get the bridge fixed, but it was done with FEMA money, and we finally got the bridge repaired, so Fern Ave is open all the way through Congress Street to Market. So that's the construction updates for now. And so now back to my guests. And again, I have Mike Basque, our Chief Financial Officer, who's with us. And this is that time of year in which all cities and towns in Massachusetts have to set the classification of the taxes, which is a technical term, and very confusing for not just residents who may not be involved, but even a lot of folks who are directly involved in this, as to, you know, what it is that municipalities are doing this time of year, and what are the components. So help us out here on talking about what we're doing right now and setting
the taxes. It's always a great time of year for everyone when we talk about the tax rate. Most folks do believe that the municipal council, the city council, the folks who set the tax rate, when in fact what they decide is whether all classes of all values and classes of valuations will receive one equal tax rate, or will there be multiple rates, which a number of years had happened.
And define what classes are.
It's residential, industrial, and commercial are your big classes. So a lot of communities that you'll see with very large commercial industrial bases will actually tax them, those groups, at a higher rate than they will the residents. In a community like Amesbury, where 85% of your values are residential, it really doesn't make sense to do that, because you'd have to shift such a tremendous number dollars of taxes into those classes that your commercial and industrial bills would really skyrocket.
So we went through this several years ago, so it would be a small savings for the residents and a big increase on the commercial
Absolutely.
Industrial.
You really need to see a percentage, a residential percentage of at least under 80%, I think, to make that begin to work. And you, like I said, you see it in some of the communities where there's large malls and Danvers, Peabody, those type of communities. Another factor is being on the New Hampshire border. That also comes into effect. Right. Although a community like Methuen, which has large malls, it's a little bit of a different arrangement there. So next week what we'll be doing is asking the city council to decide whether there'll be one tax rate or multiple tax rates. However, I think as a side note, the issue is really always the tax rate and what it's going to be. And we've received a lot of publicity about if the rate, an equal rate is set for all classes, that our tax rate would be in the vicinity of $20.24. People say, how can it go up over $20? It's really an issue of your total tax levy, the total amount of money that we need to raise by taxation, and your total valuation in the community. You divide that out per 1,000, and that's just a mathematical formula as to how you come about that. One of the areas that concern us, and has for a couple of years now, is that our total property values in the community have dropped. They have come down. They have in most communities, nearly all. But this year, our total valuation for the entire community is $1.77 billion. That's with a B, not million. $1.77 billion. That has dropped some $68 million. The way that valuation is obtained is through the sales history. So the assessors look at all of the sales reports, of what's been selling, what hasn't, and what values. And all of those values are calculated and sent to the state to be certified. What we saw this year was a reduction in our condo market. The sales of condos have continued to decline, and we have a very large condo market, especially not our higher price condos, but more of our average and below average condos. A lot of the areas where people would say, number of years ago, went from an apartment to a condo complex. The two family homes, three family homes, multiple family homes, their values also saw some reduction. So by that value dropping is what's really causing that tax rate to increase to the dollar amount of over $20. There's really, when it comes to the valuation, we wish we could hold that a little bit more steady, but it's not a whole lot we can do. It is based on sales. One positive aspect, no one wants to see their valuation go down, but for the condo market where the values drop, many of them are going to see a reduction in their taxes this year.
So the assumption is that because the tax rate's going up, property values are going down, therefore the rate, which is just a calculation of that, is going up. Does that automatically mean people's taxes are going to go up?
No. You have to look at your own value and what happened to it. An average single-family home, which is what the state uses to try to compare from one community to another, on the average single-family home, we are looking at an increase of about $122. But anything below that average single-family, depending on what that value did this year, you could see reduction. Not only not only on average single family homes, but on any home. You really have to look at your valuation to come up with that. We're seeing that nearly as, for folks whose bills are going up from zero to say $200, there's almost as many homes with the values that are going down from zero to a negative $200. In other words, almost as many people with that increase are going to see a decrease based on their value. So it's not automatic. It's very individual. It's as to what type of home you're in and where you're at.
So we've had residents, for example, that live in a condo whose values are falling, who's, you know, upside down on the mortgage and therefore, you know, struggling with that issue, and then expressing their concerns about the impact of, you know, taxes on them. You know, what's the good news for that person who's in those condos?
Well, I think a number of them will see reductions in their taxes. However, you never want to lose value in your home. That's when values were increasing back in the before 2008, and values were increasing every year tremendously, and the tax rate was dropping a dollar or two every year. Folks would say, well, the tax rate's dropping, but it's meaningless because my values are going up and my bill is going up. And that was true. Mm. The reverse holds true now, is that if your values are going down, the tax rate is going up, but it doesn't necessarily mean that your tax bill will go up.
Right. This
year's increase in the tax levy, which is the total taxes that we send out to everyone, is up about $685,000. That's significantly less than last year.
And a portion of that is new growth.
New growth. So, right. So some 313,000 of that is really new growth.
And 369,000 is the part that's an actual increase.
Right. The other thing that's, I think, is positive, we're seeing our commercial and industrial base, their values have increased this year, which is a good sign. That's an effort that we've all been trying to make to take and expand that commercial and industrial base, which is why it's so important to maintain a single tax rate. Yeah.
So by my calculations of what I've looked at, 40% of all residents are actually going to see a tax cut or no change in their tax bill at all. 40%.
Yes.
And then out of the 60% that do have an increase, 46% of them, it's $200 or less. It's a very nominal increase, especially given the amount of investment in the schools. We've increased funding in schools by $600,000. You know, as I talked about earlier, all the paving of the streets, all these things that we're getting done for those who do have an increase, very modest.
Right. We're seeing, you know, our higher valued properties, some of them will see a larger increase, but many of them are new construction. Some of them were not totally on the tax rolls last year. Anyone who builds a new home may not have been completed as of last year, so they'll see those increases there. But
right.
So it's really across the board. You have to look at it on an individual basis.
Yeah. Now, the other news, as I mentioned, we received the bond rating increase from Standard & Poor's. Talk a little bit more about what that means.
Yes, we've been working on that for a number of years. We're continuously working on that effort. We recently received a bond increase just on Monday, as a matter of fact. We were going from a rating of A to a rating of A+. Our next goal is to try to get to a AA. And I think the biggest impact that rate changes have or increases have is that it affects the amount of money that it costs you to borrow funds. And with the projects that we have on board that we're looking to be permanently financing in the next couple of years, an increase in bond rating usually means you will get a much better rate when you go out and you bond those projects. And bonding a project is no different than mortgaging your home or a major project. The bond market, they actually come out and they bid on your loans, and the lower the interest rate, the better we are, all of us are. The reason we just received the rating increase is because we have all of our temporary loans. When we do these major projects, we take out loans usually on a yearly basis until the projects are completed. So our temporary loans are up for renewal right now. We received our bond rating on Monday, and actually we just received our bids today, so that we're renewing $5.6 million in short-term loans for 1 year, and we just received a rate today of 1%. So that's very good news. You really can't say if we didn't get the rate increase, it'd be 1.2. It's very hard to say that, but the positive rating increase usually relates to a very good and competitive interest rate.
But it's also, it's a good assessment by an independent third party who's expert at sort of looking at the finances of a municipality.
Right. There's two large players in the market, Standard & Poor's and Moody's, and you hear of Moody's or Standard & Poor's raising or dropping bond rates for everything in the world, really. You hear about countries getting dropped, you hear about different businesses and what have you, increases and decreases. So, yes, this is a major positive news.
Yeah.
When you look at their report and why this took place, what we've been doing for the last several years and really working hard at is trying to build our reserves. So much of your bond rating is how much you have in reserves in case something bad happens. The recent news about our free cash being at $1,270,000. The term free cash, it's terrible because taxpayers say it's not free, it's not cash, which is true. However, that's just the state's term that we have to use. It's really a running total of basically a profit and loss over years. We've been able to maintain that over $1 million. Last year was, I believe, $1.1 million. This year, $1.2 million. And then we have our stabilization fund of some $1.3 million, $1.4 million, right up in that area. So when these agencies look at you, they look to see, do you have any of these reserves in place? So it's very important to do that.
Yep, and these are, 4 years ago, we had next to nothing in either of these accounts.
Stabilization, it wasn't too many years ago, we had a negative free cash, and we were highly criticized for that. You know, you can't. It's a fine line. You need to have some savings. It's just like every resident in the community. You really want to try to build your savings when you can.
Yeah.
And in the case of emergencies, that's really what it's for. Right now we're hearing the state is having revenue issues again. They're considering budget cuts in the mid-year. Right now state aid doesn't appear to be on the table, but if it were, we may need to come up with some funds to offset cuts. Last year we had a great winter. We had no need to transfer money to snow.
The year before?
Not so good. In the year before, we had some $300,000 we needed. So hopefully we have a reasonable year, but you have to have some funds set aside for those different purposes. Right. And once again, it's the discussion right now with the council, I know that they're really wrestling with, is whether to use some of the free cash towards the tax rate to try to lower the rate. We've recommended against doing that. It's hard to say no, but we don't feel that the amount of money that they can transfer will have a big enough impact on the residents to offset the negatives, such as a bond rating increase, which says one of the reasons is because of the reserves and the fact that we don't subsidize our operating budget. Mm-hmm. You don't want to subsidize an operating budget with a one-time revenue, because next year you're already out of balance when you start. Mm-hmm. And the numbers that you know we look at, just I don't think they will have the impact to the residents that it might be a headline, but it the impact really isn't there, I don't think.
So it'd be like eating a whole spoonful of sugar. It'd give you a quick hit, you feel good, and then indigestion for the rest of the time.
Right, it's difficult. There's a lot of pressures, and we realize we're not happy with the tax rate. I know you're not.
Yeah.
No one is happy and satisfied with it, and efforts are made to try to always slow that growth and bring it down, but it's a very difficult thing to do. I think the frustrating thing is we've been pretty successful in controlling our expenditures, but now the value issue is coming into play where, you know, a number of years ago the values were going up, the rate was going down, and the levy was increasing by $2 million a year as opposed to $200,000 or $600,000. So it can be frustrating, I'm sure you know.
Again, as we've done our research, you know, our tax rate since 1980 has swung from highs of over $25
right,
to as low as 13. So those swings are going to happen. It tracks with the market value of homes. And we're not the only community. I know Newburyport in the same cycles have gone as high as 24. And I'm not quite sure what their lows are. But all municipalities go through these swings of tax rates. but what really impacts the residents is what's the tax bill?
That's the bottom line. What the bill is that you get in the mail from us.
Now, I hear a lot of people say, I moved to Amesbury because I could afford the house that we were buying. It was much more affordable than other communities. And that's the crux of the problem with the rate, is because our house values are very favorable for purchasing, and we had to provide the same services as other communities. The lower value, to do the math, you got to have a higher rate to have the get to the same dollars
it's
as everybody else.
It's the same formula. Yes,
yep.
It's the same formula. So that I think another bit of news that really hasn't really gotten the attention, but I think it should be, is the fact that we announced to the council that we would not be increasing our sewer rates this year, nor would we be increasing our water rates. At the very earliest would be springtime, or probably the beginning of next fiscal year. Yeah. And that's something that we've been working with the council and yourself on. As everyone's aware, the wastewater treatment plant was totally financed some 7 or 8 years ago, and we had been increasing the rates to try to avoid hitting that peak in the rate as our debt payments were coming due. And we were successful in doing that. The rate, once again this year, has fully funded the budget, and we're anticipating that for next year, so there'll be no increase in the sewer rate. The water rate we've been increasing, as everyone knows, coming upon the completion of some $25 million between the water plant and rehab of various water lines. And we've been successful in building that surplus to prevent that peak from hitting. And once again this year, we feel that it won't be necessary to increase those bills, which falls in line with the rate increase, the bond increase.
Yep.
Because we will be permanently financing part of that project. Most of it was financed through the state at 2%, but we will over the next year be looking to permanently finance that, so this bond rating increase will have a positive effect on those loans in the 20-year payout.
And maintaining our reserves now will be very important for when we go out for those bonds.
Absolutely, because next year at this time, we'll be looking to permanently finance, and if we can get ourselves up to a double A, that will really help us and have an impact. Yeah. So there's a lot of moving parts and a lot of things going on, and I think a lot of it goes on during the day that people don't realize, and a lot of hard work. We put together a lot of thoughts on how to best approach these issues.
Yep. So other than the tax rate, which is pretty much out of our control, that's a factor of the marketplace, Amesbury's finances are a success story.
Financially, we're very, very stable right now. We're very good. Reserves are up. We're strong. We really are. We have unused capacity. We unused tax levy capacity of $1.8 million. So yes, we are. We're very strong. Folks, we realize pay taxes and they pay a large amount, but I think it's they're being put to good use and they're being managed properly.
Yeah. Well, that's good news. So. All right, well, thanks for helping. I know, as I said, this is an issue even for people in the municipal business. It's very difficult to get your head wrapped around it and understand all the terminology and the relationship between all these factors.
But there's a lot of numbers, there's a lot of big numbers, and there's no easy way out.
No.
That's the other thing.
Yeah.
There's no easy fix.
Yeah, good. All right, so now we'll move to another subject. We have Sam Wilmot with us, who is the chair of the Amesbury High School Athletic Hall of Fame. So Sam, I know my 7 years in office, you're very much involved in the athletics in Amesbury and have a lot of history here. First of all, tell us a bit about the Athletic Hall of Fame, and you're a founding member of this.
Yeah, we formed a group. I put a thing in the paper asking if anyone wanted to start one, and I had three people show up at the first meeting, and then the next meeting, there was three different people. And started making some phone calls, and we were able to get a group together, something that Steve Bastien and George Doherty and I had talked about doing in the past. And so we said, we got to run with this. And so I've been lucky. I was able to make some calls to some people that were interested, and we have a really strong group together. Amesbury has a great history of athletics, and it's just not football. It's not just hockey. Girls softball, track. We've had a lot of great athletes. Some quick come to mind, Christy Gleason. Talked to her dad yesterday down in Florida. was not aware that we had this formed. I wanted to make sure that he was aware, and so Christy could get nominated. We've had some great guys, I mean, over the years, Jerry Mondalto, Jack Morrow, and you go even further back, guys like Murray Johnson and Paul Morin. I've got a whole list of people here, of coaches too, Tony Tazzaneri, Gail Kelleher. It just goes on and on. And I'm just one of those that I just want to make sure that they're not forgotten, that they should have their rightful place.
Yeah, and should bring back, just by going through this process, bring back a lot of fond memories for a lot of folks in
Ainsley. It should, yes, absolutely. I told people that I've been on the sideline with the football team for a better part of 25 years, and when we made the Super Bowl in 2008, we were the game that played at Bentley and not at Gillette. And people were all upset about it, but it turned out to be a great thing for us because we were the home team, and our stands were completely full. They were 6-7 deep on the sideline, and I saw people there from the 40s, from the 50s, right on through. They were just so excited. Mm-hmm. And I tell people, of all the years being on the sideline, that's one of two times I ever heard the crowd during a game. Yes. And it was just amazing. And so since I put this out there, I've gotten 35 to 40 applications, got a bunch of phone calls, bunch of Facebook messages. And so we have, the plan is to have the first class by fall of next year. We want to have a banquet. We want to introduce them at a football game. But I have to stress to people that anybody can nominate somebody. It doesn't have to, you don't have to have been an athlete, you don't have to have come from Amesbury. You can nominate somebody, you can go on the school website, there's a drop down right there that says Athletic Hall of Fame. If you have any questions, they can call me or anyone on our committee. And when that first group, we want this first group to be the real special one, of course. I mean, we want them all to be, but they have to be nominated. And you know, you can say, well, this guy should have been or this girl should have been. You got to make sure that you get them nominated, and like I said, you don't have to have been an athlete, you don't have to come from Amesbury. All you got to do is just nominate, make other paperwork.
So, and usually there's some type of criteria set for those who can be nominated.
Yes.
So, what kind of discussion around that?
We have three categories: you have athletes, coaches, and contributors. Athletes have to have been played at Amesbury for at least 2 years and been out of high school at least 20. Coaches have to have coached at least 10 years, at least 5 in Amesbury. And then contributors have to be done their service for at least 5 years. And we have talking about different people that have helped out, like, let's say, contributors. You had Dick Bowley, who was a PA announcer there for 40 years. Mm-hmm. You had Skip Jutras and Zip Sapora, who used to sit up on top of that press box. It didn't matter what the weather was, every game they were there, taping the games for us. And you've had, like I said, great coaches over the years. You've had Jerry Mondalto was an outstanding baseball coach. George Doherty was a great hockey coach. Leo Dupree at top of the list for everybody. And as is Tony Tazzaneri. And so, you know, you have people like that they need to be recognized.
Now, so folks get nominated, there's some kind of process, and then there's a selection made.
Yeah.
What happens then with the selectees?
What we'll do is, our cutoff date is April 1st to get applications in, and then our group will decide, we'll have a vote on it as to the first class. First class will be 10 to 15 members. Each year after that, it'll be no more than 5. Once somebody's been nominated, if you don't make it the first time, it doesn't mean that you've got to, reapply. Just means you didn't make that particular class, and that will stay. And we just hope that people will look back and say, geez, this guy back in the 40s, and there's some great reference books. Bert Spofford did his history books on baseball, basketball, football, and hockey. That they're available in the library. Newspaper clippings, if you know awards that they've gotten. I had one guy from out in Springfield nominate his dad. He called me and he sent me this great package of all the times that and I knew this guy when I was a young kid, but I knew him when he was older playing semi-pro ball. I never realized what a great athlete he was in high school. And when I started talking to other people, that's right. I just don't want we have a rich history, and I want it to be remembered.
Yeah. So, and then any plans of having some place for physically recognizing people?
There will be plaques. It'll be similar to what Effie has on the wall in the front of the school. and it's going to be along the walls of the gym. Mm-hmm. And the recipients will also get a copy of that. Provident Bank and Charlie Cullen, I can't thank them enough, because Charlie jumped right on board. He said, absolutely, we have to have this. And so they're going to help us the first year. They're going to sponsor all the plaques and help us get going with the banquet. And as soon as we talked to him, Dick Peek, who was on our committee, I talked to him. He said, we'll talk to Charlie. Went and sat with Charlie, and I'd never met him. It was like talking to an old friend. He was so excited about it. But that's typical Provident Bank, jumping right on board to help.
Wow, sounds like a great idea, great effort. I know it took a while to make this happen. You were persistent on it.
Yeah, it did. I it's just something I strongly believe in. I've been around the program for a long time, and it means a lot to me. I'm just glad that these people that we have: Dick Peek, Bill Burnham, Gail Kelleher, Kathy Mermacost, Tim Hoyt, Steve Bastien, Dave Randall. And you know, everyone's at every meeting, and we're working really, you know, very doggedly at it, and it's something that we all really want to do. Dave Bailey, he's going to help us coordinate with the banquet and stuff. So, you know, I called him, and yep, sure, no problem, I'll be there.
Yeah.
And so we're very fortunate, and we hope the first one's a real big one, and it'll be for years to come.
Yeah. No, I think it'll be great for a lot of people in Amesbury. Again, it'll be a chance to go down memory lane.
Yep.
It'll help to document the history of folks who have made a mark in Amesbury. And we appreciate your effort to pursue this, make it happen, make it real. And I think we all look forward to seeing the results of the first class.
We're very excited about it. And as I said, just get out there and just nominate somebody. That's all you have to do. It's not hard.
So say again, if somebody wants to nominate a candidate,
yeah, just
where
go
do
on
they
the Amesbury High School website, and you'll see it. It'll say Amesbury Athletic Hall of Fame. You can print out the application, or I'm in the phone book. People can get a hold of me. I'm on Facebook as well. And be glad to get you the information and get it going.
Okay. Are there any former Amesbury High School football players sitting next to you that might be a candidate for a Hall of Fame?
Well, I know one, but he's real shy.
Sam's going to nominate the rest of my teammates.
But I do believe you're one number 16, because I was a ball boy then.
Okay.
Okay. Well, again, I think this will be a great addition to Amesbury and documenting its heritage. And giving recognition to folks who may have just gone on with life and never realizing that, hey, we will remember, we'll come back and recognize some folks.
Yeah, like I said, one thing I want to stress is that it's not just guys, it's girls too. Yeah. And you know, anyone that has information on, I know the records weren't kept as well, you know, like say for track. I have a great coach that comes up to mind, is Bert Fecto. Every time that I talk to, I want to say the old timers, they'll say Bert Fecto, what a great track coach he was. If people have records on any of the girls' sports, I know Chris Perry does a great job of softball, but the other ones I'm not so sure. Field hockey, Gail Kelleher, it's got great records, but the other ones we want to make sure that they're recognized as well.
Yeah.
And it's not just a football thing. It's not just a guy thing. It's all athletes and or anyone else that has contributed over the years.
Yeah. Terrific. All right. Well, I want to thank both of you for coming on two quite dispersed topics, but that's okay. You know, I think the residents watching this program is to inform and educate the public about things going on in Amesbury with the city. So thank you both for your contributions to that. So that wraps up our show for this month. I thank you for tuning in. This show repeats on Tuesday evenings at 6 o'clock. And on Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. And until next month, we'll talk to you then. Thank you.